Title of the session is High Performance Computing Will Make or Break Cyber Security. And we have our speaker, Dr. Phyllis Schneck, who is a former deputy under Secretary for Cybersecurity and Communications, U.S. Department of Homeland Security. So let's welcome our speaker.
Afternoon. And I usually like to walk around, but the mic is right here, so I'm going to stay right here. Bear with me. But thank you very much for all coming out. We're all out here in San Francisco to talk about cybersecurity. We've had the same conversation for 20 years, and I want to figure out how we can add to that. One big deal is that I am the former Deputy Undersecretary for Cybersecurity and Communications at Homeland Security, so today I speak on behalf of myself, not on behalf of the U.S. government. So these are my opinions as a scientist, but I'll talk a little bit about what we did and what the great team that I had the privilege of leading was able to build, what we learned together, and where I think government and private sector can go with the great technology that this community can build. And part of why I wanted to come out here today is I want to engage the global cybersecurity community in an area that has traditionally been tangential. A little bit parallel, no pun intended, but really working as I go back to my roots, what they call high performance computing or supercomputing, and looking at what does that mean? How has that built our problem? How do we use it to solve it? How do we connect our cybersecurity experts with the people that are building the vast, powerful computing that we can use to help solve the problem, and that I believe our enemies are very often using against us? So a little bit about, in my former role, I had this awesome opportunity to talk to one of the people that helped develop the internet. This man was there when some of the first packets were sent. And I said jokingly, sir, we're in a skiff, so answer however you want, but when you built this and you shipped the first packet and you thought about what this meant and you started building what was ARPANET, what is ARPANET, what led to the internet, did you think about, you know, security? I think that's what I said, because I got nervous asking this amazing genius this question, and he said, yeah, but we didn't need it. And so here we are. So as I look at that, we have a lot of lessons that we can all learn. I think everybody in this room was probably 4 years old when they made that decision, so things change. But we have constantly out-innovated our ability to secure what we build. And the issue is, as we build more and more, and I was able to get to see some of the expo floor this morning and talk to some folks and hear what they had to say, there's even better coming. But with the technology that's coming, we have to take a step back and look at what does that mean. Again, not preventing the bad guy, but looking, as I dig into my past 3.5 years in government, how do we just mean we stay resilient? So we're not going to catch everything. Buzzwords are not going to solve the problems. There are great devices, but how do you organize them and use them and pick and choose in a way that makes sense for your network? And how do we look at this fast-moving target of processors constantly getting faster, compute power getting better? That is what the adversary has over us. And yet there's this major disconnect that I and others have had the opportunity to both participate in and contribute to, as well as see and try to help, where the fast computing world is somewhat separate from the cybersecurity world. And if I'm wrong on this, I'm leaving lots of time for Q&A, so call it out, because I think it's a conversation we have to have. But I'm looking to merge these two communities. When I was in government, I was running the leading a team of 2,000 of the finest scientists I've ever met in my life, working for the National Protection and Programs Directorate of the Department of Homeland Security, doing the defensive cyber operations mission. And we looked at how do you look at not only incident response, but how do you take what we learn from protecting all those government agencies and private sector and put that together in a meaningful way, and then going forward a way that is slightly easier to use, and I'm not trying to be sarcastic, but really how do you take that data and that information and put it together more quickly? How do we learn on the fly, and how do we enable that to be part of our network as we build kind of a self-healing network? And we did that with the background of how do you look at cybersecurity to not protect a device, because frankly, I don't care about a device. I care about what it does, what it holds, the data it holds, the electric grid it keeps on, the water it cleans, and the food it purifies. All the information that we keep track of, all the public health, all the private information, all the wisdom that we gain from working with our privacy and civil liberties experts, how do we protect that. And so that is part of the mission with resilience. We started working very closely also under that National Protection and Programs Directorate banner with the Federal Protective Service that also worked for my boss, the former Undersecretary Suzanne Spaulding. And the Federal Protective Service, you may or may not know, in this community protects about 10,000 federal buildings across the country, across the US. So they see things like, and I'm not even making this up, I wish I were, the router in the closet that is managing the IP cameras for an entire federal building. There are probably a couple of people on the team that know where that plugged in. There are probably a couple of people that know it's even there. Maybe somebody thought to secure it, but it is actually part of the network of that building, if not greater. How do we start looking at where cybersecurity is built into managing our physical assets? How do we start knowing that it's there? And you can get where I'm going here, but there's a lot of data that comes up with that. You've heard a lot of buzzwords about the government programs, which I'm proud to say the team made very, very successful. As an overview, just look at this from a summary of the data. I call it the exhaust. I had a fun time with that word, but as things run and they protect and they do their job to protect a network, they're spitting an exhaust out the back of a bunch of information that we should be using better. Every time a computer runs, it learns something. So the Einstein program, one of the things it did was intrusion detection and prevention. Admittedly, I told the government it was not 10-year-old technology, it was 25-year-old technology, but it was very important because it blocked and tackled on classified information, et cetera. But it also gave the government a situational awareness that no one else had. All the traffic, all the net flow coming in and out of all the federal agencies. And a few years ago, the government started really using that, putting it together, building a beautiful network cluster, building the rack rooms we needed across the country to store that, and actually mining it and using it with the help of privacy and civil liberties experts across the department and across the country eventually, looking at how do you do this and how do you do it right with only what we're allowed to see, but actually that's quite a bit when it comes to just computer operations and not personal information. How do you find trends in that? How do you tie that together to another program I know you've heard about called Continuous Diagnostics and Mitigation? For fun, I entered the government I was nominated in June of 2013, 5 days after Snowden came out. I had been active on what they called continuous monitoring before that. And when I got to government 4 months later, it was Continuous Diagnostics and Mitigation because they're not allowed to utter the word monitoring ever again. But that program has a unique way to look at. And at first for the federal agencies, how do you bring the best of the best, your private sector technology from all over the world, into federal government agencies? And how do you make each of those different pieces that comes into the federal agency talk to one another? So different devices in different phases. And how do you make it dynamic so that at any moment you have kind of a thermostat of, or a dashboard like in your car, gas, oil, lights, and tires, of how healthy or how secure the network is at the time? And one of the key things that the government will have as that rolls out, and it's a slow rollout because as I shared with folks when it started, it's some assembly required, a little more than IKEA, but it's network infrastructure and that's to be expected. But as you put that together, you will start to see trends across different parts of the inside of the functioning of a federal agency network. What that gives them, again, is that dashboard. What it gives the government on a broader level is everybody's dashboard. I called it the mother dashboard. And as that gets set up, the government will start to see, again, just for the federal agencies, different security events being flagged by different ones of your products that are not only keeping the government agency safe, but now the government's getting to collect the exhaust and look at it so that one anomalous event in one agency might be ignored because it's not a big deal. It's just one agency. That's all they see is their one agency. If it happens across four or five at the same time, it likely is a bigger deal. And that's something that, again, that situational awareness could help. So they're building that data set as well as that protection capability inside the agencies for dynamic protection. They have the perimeter protection with the Einstein program. And they also built out a program in infrastructure protection that looks at, within our operations center for the control systems, looking across the country at who's exposed, who in the smaller, this is mostly a symptom of the smaller companies, not the larger ones, but who took the control system software, the control systems being not, they don't speak internet protocol, but they certainly do have electronic signals that make circuits open and close that create a yes or no for water to flow, for example, valves in electric or nuclear or rail systems. How do you open that software up, take it right out of the package, configure it with password one and let it talk to the open internet? So a whole other side looking at that and looking at that data, working with those customers on the internet incident response side. There is a whole set of data among the finest team on the planet that they are just beginning now, as the vision was to start to mine and use and make sense of. Now, where would that go? Because as you start to build out, and this is where I started thinking about with the team, some of the bigger issues of how do you do the computation on this? So if that's just one agency's and one government piece's role, then you start looking at how do others play in that? How do you work with the private sector? So all these private sector companies have different products that create massive sets of exhaust or information that they're not using yet. And then you get into this phrase you've all heard called information sharing. I'll give that one. That one's 30 years old. And it's a great idea. It comes under phrases like connecting the dots, sharing, partnership, you name it. It has manifested between people sending pretty PDF reports to each other. It's finally come into its own of phone calls and relationships. And the department last year was able to make it real machine to machine in actual milliseconds time, months to milliseconds as we called it, getting machines to actually send real indicators to each other to hopefully warn the machine of an instruction it shouldn't run before it actually runs it. Or even if it does run it and the adversary does penetrate, you can actually know that it was there, you can share that information, you can see patterns. But what do you do with all that information? That's why I wanted to come here today. There is so much data that could be collected that isn't. Again, this is not private information, this is computer indicator data. Just across the government alone, there is a lot of great threat intelligence that comes from private sector products that those companies are doing beautiful things with, but they're not yet putting it together. Part of that's competitive, and we get that. But part of that also is it's hard to sell one data set, but if it was put together, it would be very, very valuable to the community. But then there's no central way to start to look at how within our network system and in our internet, we start to make a more self-healing network. Because this problem boils down to, in my belief, one thing, and that is an adversary has an opportunity through existing malware or expensive zero days to have you execute the next instruction in memory and have it be theirs. End of story. And if we can make computers more aware, our network's fast. It's actually pretty dumb. It's not smart, but it's very, very fast. So how do we leverage what experts are calling this? Some people fear it. They call it singularity. They think all these computers are going to get smarter than humans one day and start bossing us around. I think 2040 is the date for that, that some of the futurists are looking at. How do we take that very, very efficient, speedy capability and make sense of these disparate data sets? The government now has an ability, again, with automated indicator sharing to, in real time, push data from machine to machine, but that doesn't do anyone much good if you're not prepared to consume the data, and we as a global community can't consume all of it and say, what's the global trend on this? Can we look at things happening across the electric grid at once? Can we look at the products that people are running and say there's an issue there, a vulnerability there? Are we politically able and policy enabled to put different data sets together, working with the privacy folks? Are we making good enough use of private sector data? And we started doing this in government, private sector data before we only use government data and tying that together with it. And it comes down to what I saw was two things. One is where on earth would you calculate all that and process all of that and then get it to the right place at the right time? And secondly is if I did do all of that, how on earth would I get the right information to the right machine at the right time? It's a nice thought to think that we're sharing a bunch of information and we're pushing it all out in real time, and that was phase one, and we did it. But phase two is making it consumable, and phase three is making it useful. Consumable means the private sector products can be designed to start to incorporate this. Whether it's the protocols they use today, I don't know. That's up to the private sector to drive that market and shape that market. But how do you consume enough data, get it to the highest processing computing available, make sense of it, because what you're seeing is one tiny piece. What the government sees is one slightly larger tiny piece. If we had the ability to put it together, we would eat the adversary's lunch because we'd wipe out a lot of the noise and truly be able to focus on the sophisticated events and the sophisticated attacks. So what I want to do is engage this community in how we look at the national labs, how we look at the companies that make the larger computers, how we define requirements for what we would need done as a global community, government and private sector, how we would focus on being a part of the design of the next supercomputers, even the economic models. How do you buy compute time? How do you buy compute time from the national labs? How do you buy compute time from other folks that have it? How do you buy these products? how do private sector companies, and these are unsolved problems, I'm coming out here with a big problem and only a small solution, but how do you take private sector data feeds that are worth money to companies, this comes from their products and their development, and put them together to make a greater community value and everybody still make money off of that economically to fuel future research and the good of the company. So to me, the information sharing problem is truly a high performance computing problem. It's where do we do the calculation? You can do some calculation locally, and then I'd argue that you push it up to another capability. I am not arguing at all that be in government, but what I am saying is that we, the global cybersecurity community, need a lot more partnership and work with the people that are building the big machines of the future. Because those machines today are being used to analyze DNA to make targeted drug therapies, and that's all done with speed. It's literally matching whether it's a fancy transform algorithm or it's just a literally linear order algorithm to try every possibility and be done when you get there. They are going through at speed looking at what is a match. And if we can start doing that same thing in cybersecurity data, we're going to start seeing patterns we never knew were there. And those patterns will show us everything from by sector, whether it's electric or water or rail, different vulnerabilities. We'll be able to isolate in certain products that are run what's causing certain things, down to certain behaviors of employees. But really looking without being Big Brother, at what are the requirements the cybersecurity community needs for the high performance computing community. As the HPC or the high performance community building community grows, they start looking at how do you build a machine from the algorithms to the hardware, and obviously tying those both together. We have supply chain issues in chips. I had a lot of questions when I was in both government and private sector before. Are you worried about where something is made? That's the wrong question. For the past 10 years, it had some validity, but going forward, it can't. Cybersecurity technology is a global issue, and we have to be able to computationally verify that something is what you asked it to be. It is what it's telling you it is, without looking at where it was made, because bad things and unintentional things can happen wherever the factory is. So looking at how do we verify our own networks. So when I think about the self-healing network, which is somewhat the vision, taking our computer networks and making it more of your body's immune system, right? Your body doesn't have a conference call to fight a cold. It catches a cold on a 747 and you fight it and you're fine in 3 days. It doesn't kill you. On the internet, it's a little bit different. And we start naming the thing and sharing information and having a big news day for it, and it takes a bunch of people out. What we want to do is make sure that these machines, as the traffic passes, number one, can we put more logic into the networks? There was the big debate, I don't know how many here are actually old enough to remember this, but at the end of the 90s, the big debate on do you put logic in switches or do you keep it at the end? Should we be putting more logic in the networks? And at what point do we rely on, again, big computing to inform the networks of what they should be looking for? When you get to the endpoints, how much calculation is done there? Obviously, you don't want a whole lot done on your cell phone. It burns the battery. But at some point, you want your cell phone to be informed by a lot more information than it is. So how do you deal with the endpoints getting the benefit of what the big machines have and understanding what to run and not to run? Because I believe we've actually hit our limit in what we can do as far as anything related to prevention on an endpoint or on a gateway or on a server. There's only so much we're going to recognize. Our analytics are time crunched at best, likely because we don't have enough information. That's been my experience. If we had more data, more information, we'd have it. I believe the community's headed in the right direction, but I see information sharing getting a very, very big head start from the US government and a lot of help from the Hill and the private sector the past 18 months. But that will stall, and I've thought a lot about this problem, if it's not addressed with two sets of really good, thoughtful mind share. Number one, how are we going to leverage pulling all that information together to make sense of it? Just the idea of sending a lot of data to each other is fine when you're dealing with a botnet or some new variant of malware, which happens every other day or more. But it's not fine when it comes to the sophisticated stuff. And things that we could have seen if something happened on one side of the planet and happened on the other side of the planet. We own the internet. We built the internet. We do have to secure it, as this gentleman admitted to me that day in the skiff. It is our responsibility to know those two events happened because we are connected. And in a world where high-speed trading is affected by the length of the cable and people are buying rack space in New York City to make sure they're closer, it is our responsibility because it's our capability to know that those two things could have been detected. So what I'm asking for and what I want to work at is with you is how do we get this community more involved, again, in the requirements of how we go forward in our high-performance computing. That is something that our top scientists in the world have been working on for many years. We have computers that play game shows. We have computers that play chess. I want a computer that wins at cybersecurity. We're applying this a lot, again, to drug therapy, to diseases, to other problems. They found the ozone hole this way. My career actually started in tornado prediction this way, which is very, very similar to the work we're doing in cybersecurity. My internal code name, which kind of went public a little bit for the work that we did in government, was I called it the weather map, because you look at information sharing. I had a 1913 weather map just before a hurricane that killed hundreds of people because they couldn't predict it. That weather map had various states reporting, you know, temperatures, wind speed, that's it. If you fast forward a few months later, Marconi invents the radio, and now your weather map has this information shared, but not just shared. Because it was able to be put out, it was put together and correlated. And where we are now is we could have analyzed that, which is what the weather people do now. They analyze it days in advance and give different models, and they literally get people out of areas that will hit devastation. So it's not perfect, but it's getting there because they're putting that compute power to it. The new frontier on this one is cybersecurity. But the next piece of why that's not yet ready to work, even if you had all the big compute at that and all the information, is how do you collect it? So the current models are distributed, and that may or may not be the right model. But if we see an indicator, we agree, we as government, we as some company, we as me, agree to send it out to 9 of our closest friends or everybody. It's all voluntary, whoever you want to send it to. And then those people tell 2 friends and so on. That in no way guarantees that you're going to get the right indicators combined together at the right times. It's dependent on luck. It's dependent on how your products that are collecting the information actually decide when to send it out. It's dependent on who receives it and when they're going to collect it. So really looking forward, this is an actual math problem, but it's also a market problem. How do we line up our global cyber providers and hardware providers and software providers to ingest? And there are a lot of folks working on standards, and there are many, many that exist already. Some we're using now. You've heard of Sticks and Taxi and all the other acronyms. Those are protocols for languages to describe cyber indicators and ways to transport it. But how do we work on making sure that as we put that together, the products ingest it on their own? You as a cyber administrator, you as a cyber operator, you as a cyber executive or a researcher, a coder, it's not necessarily your job, your expertise, or even your passion to figure out when something comes in from somewhere, here's a new cyber indicator, how do I want to use that today? And actually, that's wasting precious time, and it's wasting your time. If it were built into the parts of the network that said, we are going to ingest these indicators based on these parameters that we describe, it's up to us, it's our company's policy, our agency's policy, our government's policy, but this is what we're going to do, and the indicators come in and they go out, we would have a better sense as a community of how to put those together. Right now, we are randomly firing stuff out there, throwing a lot of spaghetti at a lot of walls. Some of it doesn't land, but we like to take credit for the fact that we threw it. What I want to do is take this a step further, and I think we need the big compute power. And the irony is the big compute power and the ability to execute malware wherever we want, to create malware, and to see where instructions are running came from this capability we have in big computing. So the idea is to turn that back around and do 2 things. Use that to, number one, put more information together and get it to more people. But number two, inform the architecture and algorithms with which we build these machines. I'll give you another 20-year-old example. I don't know how many folks in here have any computer graphics background, but edge detection. If I run a painting through 2 algorithms, if I'm remembering correctly, it's Gauss and Laplace, I literally just take every pixel, every color of those paintings and make it a number and feed it as a string to the computer and have it do those 2 mathematical transforms for it and then repaint the picture having done mathematical operations to the number that represents the color. It will draw me a picture. And this works. That's just the outline of the main figures of the picture. So what it's showing you is the changes in color. And you can base this on anything, changes in brightness, changes in color, changes in texture. What if we did that in cybersecurity? And that's just one very elementary example. And that's just where you need simple, hardcore, fast, dumb, but fast compute power. And then the entity that computes that, how do we make that into an indicator that almost instantaneously gets everywhere else? And that's where it gets to the argument of, should it be distributed as we have it now, or should it be central? I will tell you with some humor and some experience, if it's owned centrally, it cannot be in the government. I'll give you that. But if we could possibly have a place where the model was push and pull, so that what you pulled was always the most up to date, And if we could have a model that then leveraged the power of distributed sending of indicators to then inform that larger database, I think you'd have a much more efficient system. And if we're really going to make this notion of connecting the dots in cyber, it's different than in traditional crime investigation or traditional even security activities or counterterrorism activities, because those are people. When we're dealing with the wires and the milliseconds, we have to be able to detect in the milliseconds. The people still need to decide what the actions are, but the machines have to find it and show it to us. And so what the department did and what I got to witness the team do and help lead is the initial early stages of this, but now it needs the private sector. It needs the private sector data to the extent you're willing to sell it or provide it, and that economic model needs to get worked out. It needs the private sector and the government to inform how we build the next machines. What are the algorithms we use? What's the hardware we use? We are running up against some interesting things in power. I remember in 1987, I am that old, I stood inside a Cray 2. It was taller than I was, but I stood inside a Cray 2. Thing used the power of a small city. It was cooled by inert fluorine gas, big fluorine inert tanks. We're running up against that today, trying to shove so much power into a chip and so much density that they'll melt before they function. So how do we work with the engineers, the materials, in order to create the amount of power to do what we need to do to make our networks more like an immune system? And how do we take this electronic infrastructure? And I believe that is in a very large part going to come from the high-performance computing world. And the issue is it's already being used against us. The botnets are just an example of building your own supercomputer, one compromised machine at a time, or several hundred thousand of them at a time. The issue I want to take is how do we take this community and band it together and really work on that? And not just the existing capabilities, but what do tomorrow's big machines look like? And what do they look like to not only protect our networks as they are, but to model what would happen if we did certain things? If we could model this information sharing work, which I have tried to instigate up to now and will do more of in the future, but look at what is that graph, I call it the graph theory problem from a hot place. I use a different word in the other environments. But how do you get the right information to the right place at the right time? For most cyber events, minus some of the 0 days, if you look back and do the hot wash on those, you'll discover that you could have prevented that. You could have known about that if those machines had detected that bad behavior. But we're all running in information security silos. So how do we inform, and this is hard, but that's why this is, I think, the place to do it, and this is the audience to ask about this. How do you inform the policy, the architecture, the material science, the marketing, the economics of how to get companies to share precious data together, to put this together? So what I would propose in the self-healing network and to make this information sharing really work, because to me all information sharing means is I shared, again, one state's temperature and wind direction and humidity with another and found opposite wind directions in the upper atmosphere, which give you a tornado. That to me is what I want to find, and I want to find it early. You have to have the machinery. You have to have the access to it. You have to have the willingness to put data together. You have to have the willingness to build products that consume cyber threat indicators, while at the same time understanding the future of what is a cyber threat indicator. We do a lot of research today focused on, we as the greater, the community. How do you stop a botnet? How do you put a lot of your events together? And that is exactly what we should be doing at the local Protect My One network now, and we can't stop doing that. But I hear the word correlation, I hear the word analytics, I hear the word orchestration used a lot, and I would love to get actual definitions of what those things are from everyone in a large crowd. They'd all be different. But if there was a way, when an instruction comes in, again, it's very rudimentary, do I execute this or do I not? And if something happens as a result of my executing something, how quickly can I notice it and tell everybody else? And while that sounds simple, it's not, because it takes a heck of a lot of computation to figure that out. And I believe the answer to that is in those machines that are right now being used to play chess and win at Jeopardy. But a lot of that can and have had huge, huge use in winning wars and government activity. But let's take those that power of computing and put it to our commercial use now and help it secure our networks. And as we go and build better and better technologies and better computing, think about how the cybersecurity community informs everything else in computer science. I believe just after some time in private sector and some time in government, that's the piece that's missing. How is this community going to better inform the technology computing community on what we need? And not just the hardware community, but the people that are building the big machines, they should be designed to do this. And hardware, whatever it is, even if it's not cybersecurity hardware, should be trained to consume cyber threat indicators in some form. and work as part of a large ecosystem without a human team having to figure out what they do with the new information they get. Because I would say one lesson we've learned in information sharing is, again, you can push it out. You can lead a horse to water, but they're very busy and don't want to drink. And so if they're collecting a lot of cyber threat indicators, great, thanks, but what are they going to do with those? How does it help them, and how are they incentivized to share that with everybody else across the ecosystem? A little bit of the public health model. I do want to open it up to some questions, because I think that's the best part of any talk, is when you're actually asking the audience or answering the audience to what they want to hear. But I'll offer this. If we don't leverage the opportunities with high-performance computing, the adversaries will. They're already doing that. The adversaries collect a lot of data, probably more than we do, because that's what they do. They have no lawyers. They have plenty of cash. They don't have a business to run. So they are able to do things and build relationships and put data together and own our networks. And I would ask that we truly band together as a global cybersecurity community and start looking at, instead of just the technology folks on just the building the machine side, look at things like Moore's Law and how often are we going to double our speed in relation to how much energy can we consume. Really look at how that helps protect the networks while we make them faster. Because most, when traffic arrives, and this is the problem and the great thing about our internet, if I send you something, you're going to get it. Because there's a lot of redundancy inside the internet, inside the networks. But maybe you shouldn't get it. And that's the question that I posed today. How do we inform when you should get it, when the network should eat the traffic or drop the traffic? And if we don't do that, the bad guys are going to do that. So I'm going to open that up to questions for now.
Hi. So you mentioned about the So you mentioned about using the botnet model, which is already using the high performance computing.
So the which model?
The botnet.
The botnet, yeah.
Are you suggesting that the botnet model should be used for detecting security holes and then reporting it somewhere? And wouldn't there be ethical notions for that?
So you're asking if we should be, we can certainly build. So to me, botnets are just a massive abuse of distributed computing. So yes, we can certainly tie machines together at remote locations and start looking for things, absolutely. Yeah, so that there's distributed, and then there's the massively parallel systems, the big machines that they hide away and you pay for time on. But yes, I do believe we could use that for both. If you're asking, should we be stringing machines together and looking for the actual holes, I'm not sure what.
No, I'm asking about the botnet model. Basically, it takes computers which are open for using that for
I wouldn't necessarily build a botnet to test it. I'm not sure, and I'm probably misunderstanding what you're asking. What I'm saying is, can we harness some of the power of the large machines or the legitimate distributed systems, even if we string those together ourselves for this purpose, to do some massive calculations and push those back out? And then how do you, as an organization, I've experienced this, where would I go for machine time? You buy it from somebody, but then am I the only one getting those results? Or then we are economically killing ourselves. If I spend, first of all, in the team that I had at the government, we didn't have a couple $1 million to buy ourselves a supercomputer. So we would have had to, and this may be the next step for the team, I don't know, but we would have had to go and harness time from a big machine to do the analytics. But then once we do it, whose intellectual property is that? It is in the best interest of the global community to ship that out to everyone. And as government, I think they have that privilege. I'm not a lawyer, but I think they do. But a private sector company doesn't. So how do you find a way economically to get these great results and push them back out? So your first problem is, how do you inform the builders of these machines to design them so that we can get these great results? And they're doing some of that now. And secondly is, how do we economically, without cannibalizing anyone's business, but put those antibodies through the internet? I think this is the biggest problem we face today. Because that will wipe out the noise, and that will let the hunters work at the sophisticated attacks. And there, yeah.
Dr. Schneck, thank you so much for your talk. When you look at this asymmetric world that recently the heads of intelligence community talk about, 30 plus nations having investing in offensive cyber sort of weapons, And when we are looking at the top 500 supercomputing list, and some nations are really predicted that they're getting to the exascale computing faster than us in the US, it seems that nations with the biggest computers, if they don't share the euphoria that you painted in terms of all of us citizens of the globe using the compute power to solve the challenging problems, including cybersecurity or insecurity, how are we going to position ourselves to fight these, to fight these computers that are much faster and much more powerful than us, and we are actually decades behind?
This is a great, great question. First of all, I watch the news too. I don't think there's any euphoria, I promise. But I do think there are good guys and bad guys in every location, and there are brilliant minds in every location. So we wanna leverage that. As far as the race to exascale, 7 years ago they said 2020. I don't know what I believe, but there are many things just below exascale that can help us solve this problem. So I think there are two vectors to what you're asking. You know, number one is first, how do we get a lot of global cooperation? I think that's a very, very big policy question that hasn't been addressed yet. And again, I think the RSA conference and this audience in particular is a good place to start. But secondly, and you mentioned offensive, my expertise is in defensive, and I'm really looking at this as how do we use our powers for good. So I'm going to stick to that. But the big thing is, yes, countries are going to compete on who has the supercomputing lead. You know, we had it in the 80s, and then we lost it, and then but this is all for good. Competition drives success across the board. If we can leverage those machines, I believe that that's a win. You're always going to have people using technology for bad things. Look, botnets are just simply because we can string together machines and create a higher clustered capability. That's all it is. So I don't focus so much on that personally. I would look at this question as how do we, again, inform that community that's building the big machines to help us in cybersecurity, to create that self-healing network through analytics and literally the materials the machines are made of, because specific calculations and algorithms tax machines in a specific way. You know, and the second piece is the economic and the policy piece, who's willing to share with whom. And the question is, the bad guys win this right now, hands down, because they don't have these conversations. They do whatever they want. So the question is, how do we have the more efficient conversation, do whatever we want in a civil way?
Yeah. So you talked a little bit about data transferring from the private sector back into the federal government. So my question is around basically how you think that's going to happen. You know, for people who are in machine learning and neural networking and stuff, our big hurdle is always, a lot of the time, first getting a good test set or getting a good training set. And you see these companies, you know, there was a guy talking at the Innovation Sandbox yesterday, and they asked, like, oh, why is your company better? And he basically said, because I have 3 terabytes of well-labeled data. So for people who are in the federal government who aren't, you know, somebody like DARPA or somebody who can just kind of throw money at the problem to form these test sets and get them, do you see a reasonable way in which we can start getting this well-labeled, good training data for some of these more sophisticated algorithms?
Oh, wow. So I understand this question because everybody came to me for training data. We had the best training data in the world when I was in government 3 weeks ago. So this is something we have to look at. When I was in grad school, we invented our training data.
Okay.
Right, we made it up. But I hear you on that, and that is something, I think there are parts of the government that have worked on that, and there are parts of national labs and certain R&D centers that are able to help with that. You have to find it, and likely the government has not done a great job of marketing that. But I do believe it's out there, and I believe you're right. You have to have a decent data set to test on. Absolutely, and if that's something that this community can help inform, I would make it known.
My question is, you know, high-performance computing is really good at simulation, whether you're doing protein folding or thermodynamic simulations. What role does simulation play, both on the attacker side and the defense side? I don't think I heard you brought it up. Mostly, I think your talk has been about analytics. So do you see simulation as being part of this new environment that HPC enables?
So it's a great question. I absolutely do, and I probably mentioned it as modeling, but I didn't go very deeply into it. Cyber is a little bit different from my favorite example, the weather map, because it has a human component to it. There's no evil warlord that's going to create a tornado, so it's a little bit easier to model what will happen with certain parameters. But I think we have enough data right now from whether it's behaviors or sectors or socioeconomic issues that we can start to model even some of the intent. I believe they have a huge role. I believe simulation has a huge role. If you look back in the parallel computing world, the concept they called 20 years ago is rollback, 15 years ago. You know, you look at something that happened and then you say, what would have happened if we had done it this way? What would have happened if we had done it this way? And how could we have designed our algorithm better? So I think that's a large piece of the issue. And apologies if I included that and wrapped it up in analytics. They are different, as is visualization. So thank you. Okay, so I'm being cut off, but again, I want to engage the global cybersecurity community in informing our high performance computing, because I think that's our future. Thank you.